education. It's the shared answer to so many of society's most urgent questions. How do we expand the horizons of our children? Multiply their dreams. Enlarge the scope of their opportunities in a way that builds a brighter future. How do we help them meet the broad range of global challenges they'll face in the decades ahead? Equip them with 21st century skills needed to succeed in today's competitive digital economy. Education is the answer to so many questions, but providing it raises so many others. Like, how do we best harness the power of technology to improve the reach and effectiveness of education efforts worldwide? How do we orchestrate the professional development of tens of millions of educators around the planet? How can students, teachers, governments, and industry all work together to develop truly sustainable change in our global education models? How can we create vibrant, productive learning environments that will enrich the lives of every student on Earth? We know education is the answer, which means there's really only one question that matters. How do we make it happen?
Good morning. My name is Brian Gonzalez, and it's my privilege and my honor to be here today moderating this panel. I'm truly excited for your participation in terms of your attendance. I'm looking forward for all of you engaging, asking questions, bringing topics. This is a panel where we are here to learn from each other. My role at Intel is to work with organizations, governments, private and public sectors to help drive education initiatives in countries. I've had the privilege to visit over 90 countries, be witness to over 350 programs. So I come today to you not as an expert in education, but as a witness to experts. And what I have found in my travels, that to really have a true transformational project, you need to have a vision. But beyond having a vision, you need to have the commitment, the collaboration, and a community behind it to really help drive transformation, to really help bring change, to really engage teachers and empower children in the love of learning. In my experience, it also takes something that the four panelists here with me have in abundance. It takes courage. One of the things that I have learned in many of the discussions that I have had with those of you that take on this challenge of transforming education is that it is a lot easier to not do it than to do it. That the moment you start planning, people will have three reasons why we're not ready. It also requires investment. There was an excellent presentation earlier today, I hope some of you have attended. We have on the panel the moderator. It was excellent because it talked about vision and commitment. It talked about looking at education investment as a long term, not just a short term. It talked about education investments, not about the next election, but for the next generation of youth in the country. I want to go back here to a quote from Mr. Mandela that we all know and we understand the power of education and the change that it can bring. But we also recognize that the state of global education is in a difficult, very difficult state. If I may quote from UNESCO, over 31 million primary school children drop out. It's a big number. 61 million children of primary age are not even enrolled. And the problem is even worse in rural areas. So although we talk about hope when we see videos, and we talk about hope when we discuss vision, it really takes commitment from leadership to get action going in countries. And to that effect, I am so delighted with the panel that I'm blessed here to present with you all. First of all, I have here to my right His Excellency Nicholas Sanaoui, Minister of Telecommunications of Lebanon. And at the other end, we have Mario Coronado from Fundación Telefónica. I have next to me on my left, His Excellency Professor Mabwawa, Minister of Communication, Science and Technology of Tanzania. It's a delight, sir, to have you here.
Thank you.
And as I said, I'm extra fortunate today that I have with me Professor Tim Unwin. In his work as Secretary General of Commonwealth of Telecommunication Organization, he's done a lot of work in education. I count on him to help me moderate the panel since I've seen him do it so beautifully a few minutes ago. What I'd like to do is first, as I said, take a moment to recognize that the situation globally for education is difficult. The opportunity for change is now. We cannot lose the opportunity. And we have seen from the projects that the gentlemen that are going to speak to us about have done in their countries are at the beginning of the beginning. I would not say, people ask me, Brian, you travel so much, you see so many projects. Can you name two or three that are, you know, really standing out as the role model? I think the role model is those that have the courage to try. I think the role model are those that learn from each other. I think the role model are these gentlemen on this panel that today are going to share their views, their visions, and most importantly, concrete actions that they're taking to make transformation happen in their countries. I'll ask them to please take a few minutes to talk about their projects, and then we're going to engage in further discussion around that. Your Excellency, Minister of Telecommunications from Lebanon, will you please start?
Sure. Thank you for having us. Good morning, everyone. Well, the project we initiated in Lebanon, in fact, it started with an objective, two objectives, in fact. One is the dream of having schools go to students go to school without the heavy box of books and everything, and instead having a tablet, which is much easier. And the second thing was that the new generation of kids, and especially those with low revenue parents, would have access to this new wonderful tool that is the tablet. That maybe our kids, we see them growing and learning very easily to use the tablet very when they are very young, and we know that other low end revenues, maybe until 18 years and even university, they cannot access these new tools. So this was the dream, let's say, of equipping a whole generation with these new tools, knowing that it's not easy, the budget is not there, because we have budget constraints as a government, etc. So a lot of challenges along this, the way to this dream, there was a lot of challenges. One of them being the educational system has to be able to absorb these changes. The teachers have to adapt to this new technology. The way of teaching has to change. We need the connectivity in all schools, which is not secured anyway on the fixed network. In Lebanon, it was not secured. We had a connectivity on the mobile network because we have now 3G all over Lebanon. So we had to adapt also the tablet or the specs of the tablet to the situation we have on the ground. So having all these constraints, we came up with a first phase, which is a commercial launch, a commercial approach, not a governmental educational approach, a commercial approach, where we have the 3G subsidized. We have the interest, the banking interest free, and we had an affordable tablet that we designed together with a vendor to have proper security and the proper cloud access, And then we made a bid to have the lower cost possible tablet. Intel won the bid, and now we have a commercial offering that is very accessible, high value at the lower possible cost, that is already available. 1 year after we launched the project, it's already available for people, for parents to give to their children. And we coupled this with a pilot phase on the educational system, 500 free tablets for the Ministry of Education so that they can start preparing the schools, the school system, start training the teachers, and make a pilot phase on full school year, so that maybe the next in the next budget year we can then hope to purchase it on a larger scale for the school system if the school system has adapted itself. So we run it in parallel. The educational system has a slower pace. The commercial approach is much faster. But at least the ecosystem is starting to build. We have job creation because one of the bid conditions was that you have to hire, you have to assemble in Lebanon the tablets. A lot of people from the new generation are going to be able to access this new technology and start adapting to it.
Excellent. Excellent. Very, very good. Your Excellency, being a professor, I know education is very near to you. Also, you talked about some of your projects when you and I spoke yesterday and the vision and the commitment that you've seen in your country to drive these types of programs. Can you share a little bit with us?
Yes, please. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. As you know, every country in this world tried to improve the education system, whether the countries in Africa, whether the country in Latin America, whether countries in Europe, anywhere. Those who try to improve, they want to look at the best result of the education system. Like Tanzania, we've got a number of problems, especially in education system, and we want to find solutions. There's a number of solutions from ICT solutions and other solutions from teaching point of view.
Yeah.
But as you know that Tanzania, we have got around 7.9 million students at the primary schools and 166,000 teachers, where you've got a ratio about 48.2 for one teacher, 48 students for one teacher is a very big number. And most of those schools are located in rural areas. And some of our teachers, they are not happy to go there due to the difficult conditions. So here the government decided to come up with a number of initiatives in order to solve these problems. And from the government perspective, we decided to solve this problem by using ICT as one among the tool to solve this problem. So before doing that, the government decided to build the national infrastructure. Because if you want to use ICT, you need to have a backbone which help you to deliver the content or to deliver any service, whether it's e-service, whether it's education, with anything. So we decided to build that, and we built around 7,850 kilometers of national ICT backbone, where it has been connected to each of our regions. And soon we're going to our districts. We want to make sure that all our schools should be connected to the national ICT backbone. Also, we've got a project where we have got a free bandwidth capacity we're going to distribute to school and hospital. The government bought that bandwidth and capacity in order to give the service to the school and hospital and other government services. That is in a place. Another thing which we've done before going to do this connectivity is to educate teachers. Because from the morning panel, we have seen that teacher education is very, very, very important. I have experienced some of my cases. The school has been given computer, have given everything, but people, they are not willing to use the facility. So first, we decided to educate teacher in order to understand how to use facility, they need to afraid, there's no need to afraid of this equipment. Then from that point of view, we have got two main projects going on in the country. The first one, or main project, we call Tanzania Beyond Tomorrow. Means what we want to do is using a technology to improve the education. So here we've decided to connect a number of schools. Some of them will be connected through national ICT backbone, and some will be connected through the towers using 3G system. And the interesting thing here, we have come up together with the private sector. Tanzania, which we call Vodacom Foundation, has come up together. We agreed that we need to connect, using their site, a number of schools. Also in those rural areas where they have no electricity, but Vodacom has got a tower, and using generator, we can use the electricity to power the school and also to power ICT labs. So this project is going on, and we expect end of this year we should be able to connect around, I think, 400 schools with Vodacom together. Then from there, there's another project which is working very closely with ITU, is also we call e-school connectivity, where we've got a special project to connect with ICTU, with ITU, to different schools of Tanzania. But we have done that. There's a number of challenges. The big challenge, biggest challenge we are facing now is content. Content is a big problem. I think it's not good if we can, there's a lot of content, maybe internationally we can take it, but we want content which really reflect Tanzania perspective. We can't just take content from Kenya or from other countries. We need to have our own content. So this is a big challenge. And again, with the private sector, we have managed to change or to convert our content from normal process to digital using, with the help of Vodacom and the other private sector. And I'm sure soon we're going to do for science subject. Now we have done for art subject, then we're going for science subject. Another challenge we are facing is definitely connectivity, especially in rural areas. Some areas we haven't got, remember that Tanzania, the population is very big, and we've got an area around 947 square kilometer. It's a vast country. So some area we have got a big problem even of voice connectivity, mobile phone. So those area I think is going to be a big challenge, because you see you have got a village, here maybe you have got 200 people, there are 200 people, there are 300 people. So it's becoming more difficult, but we try to see if maybe we can using connectivity, using satellite or other technology, in order we can speed the process as soon as possible. Thank
Excellent.
You very much.
Excellent. Interesting, and we'll have more discussion about the role of the teachers and how we engage them. So I want to hear from all the panelists. Sounds like you have obviously done that. Also the area of content. There's going to be actually a panel later on today that's going to get focused on content, and I recommend that you look at that also, but we'll discuss it more with the rest of the folks on the panel. Mario, I want to come to you now. Obviously I know Telefonica from a lot of different personal experience, having lived in Madrid for a number of years and traveled in Latin America. And Telefonica, in the work you're doing, you're very much involved in education and healthcare. First of all, tell me why, and then tell us a little bit about it.
Good morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here. Thank you. Telefonica, as a group, has always been looking at the fact that in order to be successful as a company, we need for the countries to be successful. And everywhere, definitely the key issue for development is education. We're centered in three different issues. The first one is reduction of child labor. When we've engaged in Latin America with governments and directly with kids in schools to try and help reduce this problem, because we think it's a key issue to be able to have a good education. We're working with about 300,000 kids in Latin America, of those about 45,000 in Peru, helping them go to school and helping them get a good education in those schools. We also engage directly in school innovation, education innovation, through three different programs. One is Aulas Fundación Telefónica, which is just classrooms with all the capabilities to access internet. but more importantly, a program for the development of the teachers. We believe that the engagement of the teacher is key for this to happen. Our ratio of kids to computers still quite high, and we think that in this phase of the development of ICT in Peru and Latin America in general, it's more important to get the teachers to be engaged in a process of development. And usually ICT is key in getting their incentives and getting their motivation going to be involved. Usually in this space, we work in basically four sections. One is develop a good leader in the school, directly in the school. Second, having content for the teachers to engage and get the teachers to develop their own content and to share them among them. Third, we need to generate incentives for them. Not only, it's not an issue of money necessarily, it's an issue of recognition. They need to feel recognized. And we have developed a platform that allows them to share their what they do and be incentivized for sharing that. And that has helped a lot to mobilize about 3,500 teachers in 45 schools, in rural areas, in urban areas, but mostly poor areas. This has worked in our advantage and the kids' advantage. We've been starting to see some good results with a particular reduction of absenteeism and reduction of dropouts. And we didn't intend to get better results in math and reading tests, but we're getting much better results in those schools than others. We're also applying this model to hospitals. Hospitals where kids are staying for a long time also require access to education. And with computers and books and games and specialized teachers, we're trying to reach these kids and help them realize how important education is for them. And they're finding in education not only a space for themselves, but this possibility of opening up alternatives, access to the computer, access to several things. And third, we have developed it's kind of a social network for teachers that helps all teachers in the country access different content that can help them in their schoolwork in general. For example, we have developed content for school directors with UNESCO. We have developed a program that is virtual and real, for put it in a way. It's a small class for about a week with teachers from a particular place, 100 and 120 teachers. And then we give them about 80 hours in the virtual world to develop more of the knowledge that they have gotten that week. And we have gotten really good results with that. We've already reached about 5,000 teachers in the whole country through this model, the mixed model, the being present and being virtual at the same time. We think that this network of alliances, basically, that is being shown through this web page, through this social network, is what really allows teachers to reach each other and to help each other to develop new content. Those are basically the three main thrusts that we're heading in education in Latin America. Also, we have a third subject, which is development of a digital culture, this space where art and education and science get together. This is a space where there's a lot of creativity, where especially where the young people really engage in finding out what is digital and what is the internet and what is all this from the perspective of their own interest. Just being able to explore new things and being able to go further than before. For example, one of the biggest hits is anime and all this animation that we see. Kids are really involved in that and usually allows for their creativity to just bloom, you know?
Excellent. Excellent, Mario. Professor Unwin, you've been an advocate for education in a number of roles. You've probably seen, as I have too, that there's been a lot of talk and there's been some action. Obviously, we see some great examples here on the panel. But what can you offer us in terms of your perspective of what do we have to do to really get to that next step? What's the first step that you see when you see a country successfully using technology in a form that's going to help education and engage students and bring teachers into the fold?
Thank you very much, Brian. And it's such a privilege that you've invited me to be part of this session. Seeing that slide up there has made me change what I was going to say completely and just tell you a little story about why I am where I am now and begging you to join me on this journey. More than a decade ago, I was in an African country and met a really charismatic minister of employment. And she said, Tim, you know the biggest problem we face? And she said, it's vocational and technical education. It's about skills development and entrepreneurship. We're the Cinderella. And I note your figures there. 61 million children not in school. 31 million primary school children dropping out. And boys most likely to drop out. So the initiative that I would just like you to take away is what comes out of that. I had the privilege more than a decade ago of leading our Prime Minister's Mfundo initiative in Africa, which was partnerships for ICT and education. And that's when I first got to know Intel and some of the wonderful work you're doing. And I took that minister's thought and decided that we were going to work with what people variously call street children or out-of-school youth. And in Ethiopia, and we did it in partnership with civil society, and again, that's really important. We hear too much about public-private, not multi-stakeholder, involved civil society, international organizations as well. And we helped them develop a curriculum in local languages for non-formal education. And people who were living and working on the street began to get skills that they could use to do things differently. And we were working with girls' groups, and I don't mean to cause offense by this, but there were civil society organizations there who were giving young women shoeshine kits so they didn't have to sell their bodies to earn money to work. And we were giving them technical skills and that they could use those to gain a different kind of employment. And then I had the privilege of working with is anyone from the Philippines here? But a wonderful program called Escuela. In the Philippines, if you don't have a school leaving certificate, you cannot get a job. So all those children who were dropping out of school or who had to live at home to support their parents because they were ill or anyway, these children couldn't get a job. So how can they get a school leaving certificate? And government, together with civil society, and we were involved in it, helped develop a curriculum in local language for them to get the skills to pass the exams so they could get employment. And so my challenge for us all is how can we use this kit to serve our most marginalized people? Because if we don't, political tensions are going to rise. If we don't, they're going to be a drain on the economy rather than a contribution to the economy. And so when I was asked 2 years ago to lead the Commonwealth Telecommunications Organization, I said, let's not try and do everything. Let's do a few things really well. And actually, in our strategic plan, even though I am committed to education, we didn't have education there because there are so many other people doing ICT for education really, really well. But the chair of our council, Lalit Fiaratunga, from Sri Lanka, said, Tim, you have to have ICT for education. And so I said, well, what? And within that, we're focusing very much on how we can use skills development and entrepreneurship across the spectrum, but particularly for those who haven't had the privilege of being able to be at school. And in that connection, looking and turning to the Caribbean and Latin America, I would just like to pay tribute to the wonderful work of the Fundación Omar Dengo in Costa Rica, who developed a program to help young out-of-school people to get the skills through ICTs that they need to get gainful employment. And so what we're trying to do, and it is slow, and we're not making as much progress as I would like. I'm desperately impatient. But in the Caribbean, and with another hat on, I chair the Commonwealth Scholarship Commission, and I know in the Caribbean, it's actually women who succeed in education, and it's the men who as you note here, many young men drop out. Yeah. So we're trying to develop a program that can give young men skills through the use of ICTs. And the High Commissioner in Belize, again, inspired me to commit to this, and colleagues in Trinidad and Jamaica as well, that we can use the experience of the Fundación to give these young men skills that will enable them not to have a life of crime and guns and drugs on the streets, but can be gainfully employed, can contribute to their societies, and can be part of this community of those who have the privilege of using ICTs to support their learning. So that is where the CTO is at the moment in this area, working on skills development and entrepreneurship, trying to contribute for the most marginalized, with the most marginalized. Putting computers into schools is easy. I invite you to join me in working with those who don't even have the privilege of going to school. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim. You know, we've heard some of the panel, some of their programs, and we've also started to surface some of the challenges. Someone who was going to be with us today but could not join is Alicia Bañuelos. She is a fantastic individual that has done amazing work for education in her country of Argentina. And she's been a mentor to me in terms of, really understanding what it takes to move forward. In these types of programs. And one of the things that I learned from her, and she's a principal at a university, and she's kind of the leader, thought leader in this role, is that many times the teachers are not going to be the first ones to try to bring in some of this change, especially when it's about bringing in technology into the classroom. And it's not so much because they're against it, but it is a new area for them, and they have other concerns too. And many times she explained to me that the ministries of education don't have most of their budget, which is like this much of it is on salaries and administrative costs and things that they need to move these things forward in terms of what's happening in the current system in the school. She shared with me, an anecdote that she uses is that when you bring a computer to the school, the teachers are excited. When you bring in a computer into the classroom, they're delighted. When every child in their class has a computer, they're terrified. And that was her perspective, and we have to change that. Show me a great student and I'll show you an amazing teacher. We all have them, right? But there is a movement that we really need to focus on the professional development of teachers, not so they go to learn how the computer works, but how they engage the children in the love of learning in topics that they're experts on, using technology to help transform. Because, our kids, face, in my opinion, another digital divide, if you will, which is they may or may not have a device, but do they know what to do with it in a form that's going to lead towards employability and that's going to lead to job creation, that it's really going to enrich their life. So the teachers have a fundamental role to play. And we've heard from the minister in Tanzania, the work that he's doing with the teachers already. I want to turn it around to your excellency in terms of the work in Lebanon that you're doing. You're bringing in tablets, which are cool. You're bringing in technology, which people get it. The kids get it right away, don't they? But how about the teachers?
Exactly. When you said they were terrified of the prospect of having all the classroom, every kid equipped with a PC, they are less terrified of every kid having a tablet. Because by definition, the tablet is a friendly user. Because you don't have, the computer is more completely complex with programming. The apps, when you access an app, it's already, there's a lot of effort that has been done creating the app to make it easier to go through. So the tablet is a tool that is more friendly user than the PC. So this is one step towards having the teachers accept this technology change of the educational system. So I believe the tablet is a better tool for classrooms. The second thing is I'm Minister of Telecommunication, not Minister of Education.
Right.
So my perspective and my approach is more how to get the whole country upgraded in terms of connectivity, in terms of bandwidth, in terms of technology generation. And this has been the main focus of my mandate. When I took office, there were, out of 4 million Lebanese, there were 200,000 who had fixed internet, legal fixed internet, maybe 200,000 illegal fixed internet. That's 400,000, that's 10% connectivity. And we had like 200,000 with GPRS, the 2G connectivity through the mobile network. So it's about 12%, 13% of the Lebanese population had connectivity, the rest had no connectivity. Now we are at 2.5 million in 2 years. That has either 3G or DSL. So we upgraded the whole country in terms of connectivity. That's not educational per se, but that's democratization of the access and of the new technologies and the familiarization of every household and probably every kid with the internet world. The program we did with the Ministry of Education in collaboration with the Ministry of Education was, as I explained, two parallel tracks, one for the ministry and one for the population, the commercial approach. And I think it's a success because we were able to get there in 1 year, whereas a normal track would take 2 to 3 to 4 years, depending on the difficulties. That's my take on it.
Excellent. Mario, I would like you to maybe expand a little bit also on your working with teachers. And I know that in some cases, a lot of the technology, you're bringing it where they don't have teachers. You're bringing it into hospitals, and you're really creating a virtual classroom. But what do you see as you work in your line of work in the education system, especially in Peru, that's launching some new programs? How do we get the teachers engaged? What do you see the private sector maybe doing to help that?
Let me take one step behind. Yep. The first thing is we need to realize that all actors need to be involved in education. As a nation, we need to be involved in education. And that involves businesses, involves civil society in general, the government, and all the actors that want to be there, especially the parents and everybody that is around this. For this to one of the keys is for government to realize that obviously they do have the leadership. They do have the mandate as ministers of education or whatever position they have in government. But at some point we need to, as we say in Spanish, trazar la cancha, no? Just draw the field. We need to draw the lines in the football field to make sure where everybody lays and what the roles are. And that's one of the first things we need to do. And we have, at some point, sat down with the Ministry of Education and talked about, okay, what is the role of business in this process? And we have talked about the possibility of helping develop ways to improve education in kind of a way of a social venture capital, just trying to establish how to develop these experiences that then can be used to help others to be rolled out in different space. As businesses, we bring, I think, two key things. One is the possibility of developing these new projects, developing new ideas and implementing them. And second, there's a huge expertise in rolling out, in implementing systems throughout countries. Sometimes we think that implementing these programs can be easy. It's not. I mean, the implementation is an issue by itself, and it's huge. From there, I'd like to say that engaging teachers, they first have to recognize you as a valid person, as a valid entity to talk to. And given the alliances we have developed with the government and with civil society, with other businesses, we have developed this relationship with the teachers in different spaces. And this relationship has to do with creating incentives, showing them that it can be done, mm-hmm. and creating the spaces for them to develop. And the incentives come as an additional. And as I said before, the incentives is not money, is not trips, it's education, it's recognition, it's helping them realize how much impact they can have in people's lives. And in schools, we have really focused on trying to get the teachers to first realize that the technology by itself is not going to make it for the kids. It's right. Every teacher, every part of the world is scared when all kids have computers. I mean, we have set up computers in different places of the country. We're talking about 45 schools in particular. And pretty much every time we go there, the first time the kids sit down to the computer, you'll have, in about 10 to 15 minutes, they'll be playing, all of them, no exceptions. But if you put 20 teachers in the same place, you probably have 5 that are lead users and they're already checking their email and they're just bored because they've done this before. You'll have about 10 that probably like what they're doing, they're starting to learn, and they see a possibility. But then you have 5 that they think that the mouse is going to jump and bite them. And we're talking mouse and not tablets, you know? But at the same time, it is an issue. I mean, teachers have a hard time first dealing with the technology, but then, and most importantly, realizing their own value. Because the problem is the teacher thinks that because they don't know technology, they don't have a value as a teacher. And the first thing for us was to tell them, hey, every kid needs to learn how to live. In order to know how to live, he needs to recognize patterns. He needs to look at experience in a different way. He needs to learn how to learn. And those things are something that you can teach him. He may know more about the computer now, but you know more about living and about thinking, about analyzing, synthesizing, about collaborating, about all sort of things that they need. So putting things in perspective for them not to be so scared is one of the first things we did when we got there. Then giving them opportunities. And in the other end is they also need to recognize that this technology reaches kids in ways that nothing else can. I'm going to try and tell you a story. The first time I went to one of these hospital classrooms, we went to Cusco, which is a city in the Andes, the old capital of the Inca Empire, and there's a clinic there where they take most of the disability kids that have some kind of disability. And unfortunately in our country, still in this era, there's a lot of births that are not handled properly. And unfortunately, kids don't have enough oxygen and they end up with cerebral palsy. It's cerebral brain paralysis, whatever you want to call it. And there are certain cases where the people in the Andes or the farmers don't have the possibility of dealing with the kid. So they basically take the kid to the hospital and drop it there. They think it's a vegetable because they haven't been able to communicate with the kid ever. And then the parents go away, come back in 3 months, and suddenly the kid is talking to them through the computer. The teacher has helped the kid realize which part of their body they can move. They have shown them how to use a software that allows them to pick icons in the screen and use those icons to form sentences, and the computer translate that sentence into something like a voice that can be heard by somebody that is close to them. Can you imagine the impact in that kid's and that family's life? Can you imagine the impact in the teacher to feel that they can impact that life? So ICT has a profound effect in kids' lives. It has a profound effect in teachers' lives. But in order for that to happen, we need to engage the teacher in the most basic, which is their need to impact the kids, to give them those tools that they need to impact the kids.
Thank you. Thank you, Mario. Your Excellency, you got me started on this discussion on the teachers. I want to take it one level up. In your role, how do you get the ministers of education with you on this? Because again, I go back to most of the transformational projects that I've seen, name Peru or, well, in Peru and also in Portugal and in Panama and Argentina have been led through a private partnership, public partnership that's been driven by everyone but the ministries of education initially to get started. Once it gets going, you know, everybody, you know, loves a great situation and they will join in and add to it tremendously. But how do we get that? How did you create that partnership with your ministries of education?
First, I think we need to understand that I'm a minister, I'm cabinet minister.
Yes.
Minister of Education also is a cabinet minister. As a government, we're working in the team. It's quite important that. And whenever we've got a problem, especially for ICT, I need to sit down with him. I know he has got a lot of responsibility with those passing grade dropout. But for me, I want to help education sector to improve the passing rate. So it's always I try to have a meeting, joint meeting, maybe using video conference, or we sit down together with the Minister of Education to see the way forward, how we can take this project Tanzania Build tomorrow. I can give an example. 3 days ago, our Vice President called us, myself and Minister of Education, to discuss together the way forward, how we're going to take technology to improve the passing rate of our students. Because there's a big, big problem of passing rate nowadays. So he said, this is a challenge, you guys together, you need to come up with a solution. For me, as a cabinet minister, always I will go to the Minister of Education to put my hands in order to get things done. I know if we're going to change the passing rate using ICT, the credit will come to me as a Minister for Communication, Science and Technology. I use him just as a platform, but end of the day, I'm going to jump the credit. So it's very important to work as a team here, as a minister, as a government. This is quite important. So we have no problem, and I'm sure we will never achieve anything with ICT in education without Ministry of Education. That is a no. Otherwise, we can't go anywhere.
Definitely a win-win situation where you can really get to explain and to engage with the minister so they can see that this is about, you know, raising, as you said, Your Excellency, the competitiveness of the country, not just within the school system. And what we have found in deployments such as yours, it's not about what happens in the classroom. It's outside the classroom. In many cases, the device, the tablet that they will get is the first computing device that they may have at home.
True.
And
True.
We have found that it's the younger brother teaching the older brother, that the sister teaches them both eventually when she gets her hands on it, right?
True.
Because they can, that whole kind of bonding that happens, because really it's about a community of learning. I want to turn it over to the audience for some questions from them, if there are some. If not, I have many more. But before I do that, Professor Unwin, anything on that whole area of challenge of the teachers that you want to bring up?
I want to hear from the audience, so I'm going to try and keep it quite quick. I'd firstly like to thank Mario for bringing up disability. I mean, children with disabilities have far more to gain than the rest of us in the use of ICTs. But very briefly, and I'm going to be provocative, so maybe get some reaction. I don't think this issue around teachers is really anything to do with the technology. Mm-hmm. It's shifting the mindset from traditional didactic to constructivist models of learning. So it's not the teacher, you know, the professor being up here, now you do this, you do this, you do this. It's actually, you know, the teacher being down here, listening to the needs of the people and serving that. And that's a huge, huge conceptual shift. And until we get that right, no amount of technology is going to make a difference. Secondly, I think we have to pay teachers decently. You know, in many of the countries where I work, teachers have three or four jobs just to keep their households going. Now, how have they time to invest in getting computer skills? And if they do, they'll get them and then go and earn jobs outside teaching. I think a third point, and I wrote about this a decade ago, and it's still the same now. We talk about ICT in schools, computers in schools projects. We don't talk about computers in teacher training projects. Now, I would like a situation where we get rid of all computers in schools initiatives. And you know, most countries I work in do not have an integrated computers, ICTs for teacher learning in them. Any country here, stand up and say, yes, we actually have that. And this is really important because most programs, not all, but a huge number, it's about giving them, wait for it, giving teachers, what am I going to say? It's giving teachers office skills, you know, be it Microsoft Office or Open Office, or whatever. It's office, it's not education. And it's about, you know, so many programs I go to, it's a word processing package, it's a spreadsheet package, it's a presentation package. That's nothing, I don't think, to do with learning. Mm-hmm. And it's actually how we use ICTs in an integrated way, in their diversity, to support teachers' own learning, and then that they can share that with their the young people, and not so young people, who they're helping to learn. So my plea is, let's get rid of ICTs in schools projects. Let's every country have an integrated ICT for teacher training. That's building an integrated package in all teacher training colleges. It's pre-school, it's in school. I work in countries that have tens of thousands of teachers who have no qualifications at all. If we don't start there, if we don't enable them to learn how to support young people appropriately and give them the salaries to do it, we're going to get nowhere. Thank you. I'd be provocative. Yeah.
Thank you. Very, very good. Well, I want to see from the audience if we have some questions, and happy to get this exchange going.
Yeah, it's doing great stuff.
How do we do with the microphones? Our friend's coming with a microphone. We have a gentleman here in the first row, over here, and then we'll work our way. This gentleman right there in the corner. Go ahead, sir. Please state your name and...
Okay, so Mustafa from Sudan government. Thank you very much, Chairman, and thank you for the panelists. And I would like again to raise a point which I tried to raise it in the morning session, but it might be I failed to explain it well. But Professor Tim and Mario, I think they start to touch on that issue, you see. And how about we use the multimedia and mainly the ICT in education? How could you make the best impact in improving the efficiency of education? Because some people, old like myself, in the 60s, they might remember we have like the mobile cinema. So where the governments, they have like the car with the generator. And then they use these films very structured to teach the population, especially the rural population, about the health and irrigation, improvement of agriculture, and so different materials they needed on those areas. Then later on, it came the cinema, and then it came the television. Mm-hmm. And then I remember when I was in secondary school, we have the English lessons through the television stations, where every secondary school, I mean the classroom, there is certain time, the teachers start making this training, which was different from the classical using the books and the formal grammar and so on. And there is achievement and improvement in the efficiency and so on. And now, are we going to repeat using the computer as films or making programs where the students sit in front of the computer and see programs? It will be very boring, see?
Right.
And we think there should be a way where these computers, because there is an interaction. Where Mario said about the handicapped children, there was an immediate impact. You can see the impact because there was interaction and where the computer really played a role in bringing up the education of non-educatable person. But now how can we do something for the masses to change the structure? Thank you.
Perfect. I think that's a great question. I think it has tones of also to do with content. And I think if I may summarize, it's what you really want is kids that not only consume, but get in that creation space. Not only play Angry Birds, learn about the birds, right? That we need to go to there. And maybe I'll turn it to you, Minister, in terms of what you're doing now that you're bringing in these tablets and maybe the role of interactive multimedia content and so forth.
Well, we have these tablets are linked to a cloud, mm-hmm. and both operators, they are sold by the local operators, which are government-owned. And these operators are developing a cloud solution, which is a local app store, encouraging Lebanese creators, inventors, to developers to put their application on the local cloud. And these applications, together with Intel, in fact, we're going to do a workshop and encourage an ecosystem to thrive and push most of these new apps which are related to educational culture, something that is useful to the kids, push them on the tablets that are being sold through this program so that they can have a broader environment to benefit from. This is the solution we are working on.
If I may add on that myself, a lot of the more successful starts of programs have to do with allowing for local content creation. And for example, in Argentina, what I saw was that the university students were being trained to build content, interactive, fun, exciting content for the younger kids. So they were actually gaining a skill and also providing a service. So that interaction and having higher education play a role. And if I may, maybe, Your Excellency, if you want to add to that.
Mr. Mustafa, maybe there is another thing. Take example for chemistry experiments on the lab. Normally in our cases, especially in a school, you need to buy chemicals, give student chemical, do the experiment. But if we've got a computer model of content, you repeat that experiment 10-5 times before the student going to the lab. So you can add the chemicals and you can see the reaction on the computer. Then you can get a feeling before you're going to the lab. When you're going to the lab, you don't need to repeat it many times because you know what you expect from the computer lab. So computer can help a lot to do that type of things, and you can save a lot of money, especially to buy reagents and other things.
You want to take an answer to that quick?
Just a quick step, two things. First, not sure if I understood well the question, but I think that media in general also have a role. I mean, when we're talking about a nation being preoccupied with education, I think we all do. A nation have an important, the media have an important role. I mean, there's TV stations around the world that have developed great educational content that is put in prime time every day. And I think that's one of the issues that have to be involved. Second and last is, when you allow teachers to use the technology and give them the tools, they'll find ways and they'll share it. I'll give you an example. There's a teacher in a very small town in northern Peru that just won a prize from us because he developed a whole system to get the kids to learn about their own identity. They had to take interviews from their parents and uncles and aunts and grandparents to learn how did this town was created, what happened in the last 20 years or 50 years or whatever. So before, in school, the guy that knew all everything about ICT was the ICT teacher. Now are the history guys and literature guys that are the ones that are really generating content, because those are the ones that are really engaging the kids in new ways. Because in order to learn more about geography, they just go and take the picture and show it, you know? And I think that's a really good way to just let teachers find their own content and share it with the kids and that share it with other teachers.
Excellent. I know there were a couple more questions here on the third row. Gentleman right there. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Samin Jure. I'm with UNICEF. And first of all, I'd like to say it's been a very exciting, I think, and very pleasant set of discussions that have been led by the panel there. Certainly very enlightening. I'm trying to connect some of, if I can say, some of the dots between some of the sessions that starting with the forum and some of the very high-level technological pieces we saw with the 4G LTE, things that are coming down the pipeline. Went to another session where there was broadband, enriching everything, and then coming back to Internet of Everything. And then coming back now to this session, I think, which is really more down to the ground, which is really about education, and I think an area where, so with the starting of this, we saw, you know, there's certain very, very key things about what we do with all of this technology and how then as partners, as people having different roles, we actually engage in it. One of the things that that caught me in one of the sessions yesterday was said, you know, we're looking at broadband and everything, you've got the device, you've got the pipe, and you've got the cloud. Certainly what we're hearing, part of this is also, I think, a lot of the technology, part of the devices. We're hearing a little bit about the pipe, and that's a part I want to talk a little bit about. We're looking about really looking at saying, how do we get that access to many areas where we look at the real populations that actually need that access? And granted, yes, there are operators here, there are people who have got certainly very, I think, very noble, very intricate interests in delivering and in seeing that the capability to deliver the technology is there through the connectivity. Somewhere I feel that with much of what we've got, yes, certainly I think there's good things being done, but maybe we might need to explore a little bit more in terms of the innovation space of saying, what about the spectrums that we've got? Because what we're saying is we have a lot of unused spectrum. We have a lot of TV white space, for example. We don't hear enough about that in sessions like this to say, let's bring down probably some of the capabilities that probably some of the things like TV white space could actually do to enable that connectivity and that further reach, especially in much of the challenge areas in many parts of the world, in Africa, where I'm from, for example, and many other parts of the world where that would really provide additional capability. Power, of course, is another one, because power generation, and when we're looking at that reach as well, and there again, you know, simple renewable energies, whether it's solar power or wind-based power, which would then enable further to further reach to get that reach. What I'd just like to therefore just throw a little bit into the discussion is really those two pieces. One, looking at the power generation piece. The second one is looking at that use of free of spectrum, use of the forums such as we have here with ITU and the other partners in saying, let's free up some of those other spectrum spaces that are capable to actually enable us to deliver that broadband type capability to actually enable us to enrich the capabilities that we've got. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. You know, one of the things that we heard yesterday was also in that light of, you know, everyone everywhere, right, having access. So I think how we apply ICT technology to help drive that. I'm going to rely a little bit on my experts that are here next to me to maybe address that. Who would like to?
I will.
Please.
Maybe I need to talk about Tanzania perspectives, especially in the coming issue of spectrum. There are two parts. You mentioned about white spaces. In Tanzania, we have started to do some investigation to use white spaces now between Microsoft, Helix's company, private company, and the Tanzania Commission of Science and Technology. Tanzania Commission of Science. We're dealing to see how we can explore to you that white spaces for education purpose. So this one is going on. And the second part, especially, we try to optimize the spectrum to see how we can use those spectrum. And as you know, that Tanzania will switch off the digital television part of the Tanzania in order to get those spectrum where we can use it for education and especially for last mile connectivity. Otherwise, we can't do anywhere. Concerning the issue of electricity, that is a big challenge, especially in rural areas. And we try to talk with the private sectors, especially Vodacom, as I mentioned before, that we need to use a system where they've got a power, no matter they have got a generator. Then we need to use that generator to power the school in order we can use that electricity to power the school, to power ICT and other equipment on the school. That's my comment.
Thank you, Professor.
Can I follow that? And thank you, because you've hit several nails very firmly on the head. Going back to how you get affordable internet. It's absolutely fundamental. And many of the countries, you know, Sierra Leone has 1.6% internet connectivity at the moment, going up. And that is the reality of many of the countries in which I work. So, you know, how do we resolve that? And I think, you know, as I've said before, it's trying to, you know, we've done the easy stuff. Let's now commit to working in the most difficult environment. So what we've done is working with partners. We've got external funding to help them build up an integrated national broadband strategy, which I think there are 14 Commonwealth countries, I don't know globally, but who still don't have a national broadband strategy in place. Such strategies, it's not a matter of one size fits all. It's an integrated strategy. Yes, Australia's NBN has been very controversial, but at least the principle behind it, that you're going to need different solutions in different places, is important. So it's having that holistic vision and the commitment to deliver. And how you pay for it in some very, very poor countries is also a real challenge. But I think that is where innovative regulatory models, multi-stakeholder partnerships can make a difference. On electricity, again, absolutely right. But I think there are, I'm more optimistic here. I think there are more innovative local sides coming up. I mean, there are some, you know, I'm a great believer in micro hydro, where you've got water. It's much, much more efficient than solar. And there's some good examples from Sarawak in Malaysia, where they're powering schools through micro hydro to be able to use electricity. The solar projects, wind projects, yeah, appropriate. But I think we can also change the technologies so that are less power demanding. I mean, I'm going to do a bit of advertising now, but you know, I've just recently got a new MacBook Air, and I can get 10, 12 hours out of it. And compared with the old MacBook Pro, which I got one or two at best. So, you know, things are moving in the right direction, but there's much, much more work to be done. So, yes, and I just come back to my own country and to reinforce this point about the most marginalised. 17% of households in the UK still do not have internet access. And so what are the kids in those schools going to do? So we hear a lot of good examples. We hear a lot of success stories. But you're encouraging us to get real. Brother, I'm with you on that journey.
All right, before, Mario, I think you had a point.
Just one very small point. First, I think that there's always new technologies to get more access. But I think the key is, remember, hopefully no one was alive when this was invented, you know, pen. Does everybody talk about this new technology? Well, I hope sometime in the future we'll not talking about technology. We'll be talking about how to teach, what to teach, what do we want from the kids. We're talking about education, and the real issue is we need the kids to learn. We need for them to forget about that they're writing with a pen and they're using a tablet or using a PC. I think that's also an issue. Hopefully we'll have enough inclusion then to be able to forget about it.
Mario, do you think we should be using the word learner rather than teacher more? Do you think we should be moving away from education and talk more about learning?
I think we're all learners, and yeah, we need to recognize that. I mean, the model of the only one perfect leader, I think, is being just broken up, you know? Yeah. And I think we all need to realize that we're learning from each other. Yeah. And there's a leader in the class that should lead the kids in the process of learning, yeah, not a teacher that stands up and gives the rule, you know?
Absolutely. There was a question. Yes, sir, you have the mic.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Rod Grew, Northern Cape, Provincial Government, Republic of South Africa. Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez, and your panel. There's a lot of focus on the current condition and the challenges that we have. Are there good examples of the transformed teacher training college or the transformed BS education? And of course, at the other end, the actual self-learning possibilities that are created through this multimedia technologies and good access and electricity.
Lord, an institution. Professor King.
You're looking to me.
I have one. I'll give one.
I think we should point to some of the work that Rod's actually been doing. But I think in many of the poorer countries as well where I work, I come back to what I said earlier. There are very, very few examples of this being done well and an integrated way in teacher training. I remember there's one example I would give. I don't know if there's anybody from China here, but there was an internationally funded and supported program in the five Western provinces in China, and that there was an amazingly thoughtful Professor Bernadette Robinson, I think it was, who made the point there that it's fundamentally about enabling teachers to make transformation. So what Mario's talking about. And so although ICTs were integral to what was happening, the focus wasn't on the ICTs, it was about transforming learning. And China does things at scale and very impressively. And I think, you know, once you'd made that first step in enabling teachers to have confidence, and this was, you know, using television, using in those days, desktops and laptops. But now, you know, across China, every single secondary classroom is going to be fitted with whiteboards, interactive whiteboards, and they're not being used just as a slideshow. They are used interactively, and I think that's because the focus started on supporting the teachers to have new ideas about what vision they could have to roll out learning. It's not perfect everywhere, but I would point to that as one example where the technology worked because it wasn't actually the technology that was at the forefront. And I can give you the references to that later if you want.
Well,
yes, sir.
Brian, I think I'd like to tell you about our specific case in Lebanon.
Perfect.
Okay, we're a small country, but we're ranked 12th in the as an educational system worldwide, and 5th in mathematics and science. So give you the challenges we face are not the same challenges, not always the same challenges as in Africa or Latin America. One of the things is that in spite of the fact that we have a great level of education, we have unemployment, fair level of 20% unemployment, and we have the other graduates. When they graduate, they leave the country to work abroad. So we have two problems. One is the kids that don't find an employment, and the second is the kids that find an employment but not at home. So they leave their families for many years and sometimes not to come back. These are the challenges we face. One of the ideas we came, me and the Minister of Education, and we worked together on, was it's a video that's on the web that's being made by, I think, an association called Coding Association or something like that. It's Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and all the major OTT players that made the video saying we need coders, we need programmers. So we have, they say, 5% of the jobs of the graduates are graduated in coding or programming, whereas 70% of the new jobs created are for coders or programmers. So there's a big imbalance. So there's a need, and we need to get the coding. We need to teach coding to the in schools, to get coding in schools, not only in universities. And this takes a big effort, and takes an effort in equipping the schools. So we go back to the same subject we were talking about, but it goes also to the who's going to teach them, how, and what grades, etc. And we did an effort in Lebanon on that. It's a small effort. There's a new device called the Raspberry Pi, which is really cheap. It's $25. It's a small box, transparent, $25. If you add the keyboard and the charger and the screen, maybe it will add up to $60, $70. And this is a really easy tool to work with and to get it. So you have one with you. I didn't bring mine. Okay, excellent.
Oh. Intel Galileo.
It's the competition.
Better. Even better. Okay.
How much is it?
$25.
It's somewhere under
$60.
And we have a program for universities that we are doing that I can talk to you after the panel. But again,
and
it's the building block.
You'll get your Christmas present. You know what it's coming.
But anyway,
I'll take it.
It is yours, sir.
But the idea is is to teach kids in school, to introduce coding classes in schools, to prepare the kids to be able to find employment when they graduate. And being as our country wants to be a digital hub in the region, and we're doing everything we can to make the country ready for that, this is even a more important task for us, because we need engineers, we need people to work in this digital hub we are creating. Yeah. So this is a challenge that is between education and telecommunication and digital economy.
And it's, you know, I think it's been touched upon. It's transformation is not so much about bringing the technology, it's about changing the way kids learn. Or adapting the way that we teach. I'm not sure which one is first, but it has to change dramatically. And I think that us as parents, uncles, concerned citizens, you know, we have to, you know, work with those folks that now have that charter, which is the ministries of education. But the transformation doesn't happen there first. And you know, so this is my first time at ITU, and I was so delighted to see so much talk about education, because I was wondering, you know, and now I don't wonder anymore, but it's the power that you all have, that this panel shows, to be able to make those changes. I think we have
One additional word on education and telecommunication. I sent a letter recently to the Minister of Education asking him to amend the curricula of the education. Telecommunication curriculum in universities, because they are still teaching programs that are not used anymore or are obsolete, and whereas there are a lot of new programs for mobile phones and smartphones application or for PCs that are needed. So I thought at least if the Minister of Telecommunication can express its needs, then the Minister of Education can have a list to work on and get it done.
What was the reply?
It was 1 week ago.
Where's the email?
Not yet.
We'll be positive.
It's on the way. Questions? Request for Galileo? No. We'll take those later.
There's one there.
There's a question.
Thank you, facilitator. I'm Patrick Makungu, Permanent Secretary, Minister of Communications, Science and Technology, Tanzania. And I'll join the others to to thank the members of the panel.
Yeah.
I would want to ask the panelists from Lebanon an issue that might clarify the lowering out of ICT and technology for education is something which we'd really like to take financing. Financing would be an issue, and one would be to engage the private sector or providers and to join with the public who are concerned with education. And so I want to ask from him, what challenges would that pause probably, particularly in terms of aligning the technology, because you are probably dealing with a particular type of, particularly the hardware part of it, where you might really be talking about a certain type. I'm talking about this because, as the Honorable Minister mentioned, in Tanzania, among the others which he would not have had the time to say, is engaging with a provider to put a tablet kind of technology, which would be cheap and used, but the challenge is it is a particular type. Are there some kind of regulatory or whatever, or standardization or whatever issues coming from that point of view?
I'm gonna tell you the answer of how we did it, but I'll tell you one thing. I think our experience is not necessarily the same as in another country, because we live in a very weird country. We have hundreds of thousands of problems you cannot imagine. So, for example, when we gave the 500 tablets for free to the Minister of Education to make a pilot phase on a specific schools and classes, he needed $250,000 to train the teachers, which is fairly small budget. And as I am the second, my ministry is the second contributor to the treasury in Lebanon. We provide $2 billion per year to the treasury. I said, I'm sure I can find $250,000 to give them to you. So we agreed. We looked with the lawyers how to transfer the money from my ministry to his ministry, and we find a very long and complex path that we followed to the end. It reached the Ministry of Finance, and the Ministry of Finance say, I won't transfer the money. I don't accept. Say why? Say it's unconstitutional. And this is a 2 year story. 2 years to get the $250,000 from my ministry to his ministry, and the teachers are not yet trained. So now we are trying to find some money from the private sector as a sponsoring or other type of. What we did is that we used the commercial arm of the Ministry of Telecommunication, because we are the owner of the two mobile operators. Mm-hmm. They are managed by the private sector, but they are owned by the Ministry of Telecommunication, but they are owned through a commercial law entities. They work under commercial laws. So we were able to make the bid on the tablets, to pay for the tablets, but we went to a commercial approach where they will be sold to the public, to the general public. We went to the central bank, they subsidized the interest, so they're interest-free on a two-year loan. And we subsidized the 3G. The 3G is at 50% or even 30% of the cost it would normally cost for the children. And the tablet is cheaper because we made a bid, because all the international vendors came and fought to get the deal. So we have a very nice package, but it's not for free, and it's not mandatory. So a student can buy it and another student will not buy it. So it's not 100% democratic, but it was a way forward in waiting for the Ministry of Education to prepare itself through the pilot phase, waiting for the Lebanon government to accept to have a bigger budget to buy the tablets for a wider generation. It's a first step on this road.
Great. We have a few minutes left.
Let me just comment. There's two ideas that come to mind that have been talked. One in the last few days, another one that may be new. First one is I heard that in Colombia, part of the money that was obtained for spectrum licenses was directly used in the program to buy tablets and give it to schools. That was even better for the telecom industry because they were generating more clients at the end.
Mm. Yeah.
And it was good for the schools because they were getting the tablets directly without having to go through the whole problems of transferring money between ministries. That's something that did it in Colombia. I think it'd be an interesting thing to look at. And second, in Peru, not in this subject, but in another subject, the government is working in trying to install spaces for kids, for children between 0 and 5 year olds. What they've done is that they've developed something like a module. They've done all the design, they've done all the equipment, design, and everything is ready in a package. And it's even priced. And basically, they've gone company by company saying, if you want to do social responsibility, here there's a plan for you to implement. It cost, I don't know how it was, but I think it was like $15,000. So it's like a It's like a small, instead of buying a campaign for whatever product, you can do this. And it's already designed, it's already set, the government has set the standards, and it's much easier for the companies to say, okay, I'll do one of these for that space where I operate. There's a lot of mining companies that have bought into this project and have implemented these modules. Maybe you can do a module for ICT, for example.
Yeah, Mario, that an example of acquisition of technology for education through sale of spectrum. One example is Portugal, and it's well documented, and if anybody needs more information on that, Dr. Mario Franco, who's spoken at ITU in the past and other venues, talks about that. So there, you know, the whole area, but after that, right, it has to be sustainable. So in these cases, and I know in Lebanon, the same case, there's microfinancing or some ways that the parents can sustain that. I'm very familiar with a project in West Bank, Palestine, where the parents buy the devices for the kids. And many times they may not use them in the school as much as they'll use them in the learning centers, because that's where they're actually where the education's happening, not at the school and the learning center. So again, complicated situations. So I think that there's a lot of creativity, and there's a lot of programs already that have been started that I think could serve as a guiding light or a lighthouse for all of us. In the last 5 minutes that I have, I want to ask my distinguished and just superb panel, as you speak to your peers out there, what are the one or two things that you can tell them in terms of what you would see if you were in their shoes and they're looking at starting a program? I mean, what would be the one or two words of advice that you would give them? And it can be courage or stay on it or whatever, or it can be more specific. And it's going to be like round robin because we have to be really quick on it. But Mario, I'm going to start with you. We'll go this way.
I'll start with that image that I was trying to put at the beginning. Draw the lines of the field. You know, sit down with all the players and say, okay, this is my role, this is your role. What are the spaces we can move in? And let's commit all of us to work for education in our country. I think that's the first move. And the second is that there's a lot of teachers that are doing great job today in our countries. What we need is to help those that do the good job be able to tell everybody else how to do it, and to feel that they're recognized for that good job they're doing.
Excellent, Mario. Yes, sir.
Well, I would say the future is in ICT. There's as much money as a government would invest in equipping a generation with new technology, new tools, new educational system. I think the money is invested in the right place, and I wouldn't spare on any budget towards that goal. I totally agree that building self-confidence is very important, and success stories are there, I'm sure, in any country. They just have to be exposed and communicated to everybody, because it's not only a government issue on how to get the country upgraded and the people upgraded, it's also an issue of how to get the new generation build the self-confidence they need to believe in themselves and to believe that they can do it.
The first thing for me, I think, commitment. You need to have a clear commitment, because if you don't have a commitment, you can have all those beautiful objective, vision, and all so on and so forth, but end of the day, you can't achieve anything. Secondly, I think we have discussed a lot about teachers. We need to teach teachers learning skills using ICT. That is very, very important. Then if we do that, we should be okay. But most important, commitment.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you for your chairing. I think the message I would give is we all have to be learners. And by that I mean there's not enough really good monitoring and evaluation of what we're doing. There's an awful lot that we still actually don't know. And it's really important that there is good learning amongst everybody involved. So that's the teachers, the ministers, the educationalists, in actually using this technology to deliver the effective learning solutions we want. And just to give you an example, I mean, there are programs that have had external reviews done in different ways that show completely different results. I'm thinking that there's one very well-known international program that's often lauded, but actually there's research that shows it hasn't delivered on what it claims to have delivered. And that just makes me think that we are actually involved in a huge social experiment of which we don't know the outcome. And I'm just thinking, you know, we're all becoming appendages of the machines. Most people probably here have a mobile phone in their pocket. And that mobile phone is being very clever. It's getting you to take it for a walk every day. And that's mobile learning. But also, just reflect on this one thing. There is a lot of good evidence that is now showing that our brains have fundamentally changed and are changing in terms of memory. We don't need to remember very much because the device is our memory. And you know, how many of you can remember mobile phone numbers? And when I was a kid, I used to know hundreds of mobile phone numbers. Now I don't, because it's on your machine. And just take that one example, because our young people are growing up without memories. What are we embarking on? So just leave that. You know, there is a huge amount we still don't know about this social experiment that we're embarking on. It's important.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank my distinguished panel. I hope you have enjoyed and learned, and most importantly, take the opportunity to learn from each other and share. If I could summarize, I mean, one of the things that I get out of this very clear from the success and from the challenges faced by the panel and the discussion is that it's more than just transforming education through technology. We really have to look fundamentally at the education system, look at it, as Tim said, as an integrated program. And it's, as we have talked earlier, it's about committed vision and leadership. It's about a partnership and a collaboration with the private sector and the industry, bringing together specialized devices that are not just one more tablet, but as the case in Lebanon, a platform for education that has certain attributes that make it fun to learn, but it is about learning. And I think as an industry, we can help drive that. And finally, it's about all of us. It's about the community of the parents and the cousin and uncles and all of us, not just in the hands of the education department or the teachers. We all have to engage in this lifelong learning for ourselves and for our kids. And in that note, and with how many 6 seconds left, I want to thank you and enjoy the rest of the sessions. Thank you very much.